Welcome back. Let's get an update now on our top story, and that is, of course, the potentially dangerous new variant of COVID that is spreading across the globe, causing countries to slam shut their borders to South African nations.
Professor Salim Abdul Karim, member of the Africa Task Force Coronavirus, joins us from Johannesburg. Thank you for coming on our program, sir. We haven't known about this variant very long, but early evidence is showing Omicron has a higher infection rate. What else do we know about Omicron so far?
One thing is that we now have a clear understanding of the scope of its mutations. It has in excess of 30 mutations in the key area of the virus that we're interested in. And we don't really know much about the virus because it's just been discovered, but we can extrapolate quite a bit from the mutations because it has mutations that are the same and that overlap with all four of the other variants of concern. In other words, it has mutations that are the same mutations you see in the alpha variant, beta variant, gamma variant, and the delta variant. So it's based on that that we, when we look at the mutations, we can extrapolate that it is likely to be more transmissible. It's likely to have some level of immune escape. And at this point, we don't have clinical data to indicate whether, you know, patients are getting more severely ill, but the early anecdotal information from our clinicians suggests that that's not the case, that it seems to be presenting just like the way all other COVID patients have presented.
Mm. Well, I suppose that's some good news that it's not making people any more sick so far, but how long do you think it's going to take before we get a full picture about how severe this variant is?
So generally when a variant is evolving to become a better adapted virus, it will tend to get more transmissible and it will tend to get less severe. And it's just, you know, on just very simple evolutionary grounds, if the virus and its infection makes you severely ill, and basically you stay at home or you stay in hospital, and so you don't spread it enough. Whereas people who are mostly well will be walking around with the virus, spreading it around to others. So generally, in terms of evolutionary approaches, we would expect it to be similar severity or less. But what we are most concerned about, because at this point, we're pretty convinced that this particular variant is readily picked up in our diagnostic assays. It's readily treatable with all the existing treatments we have for COVID. It's also preventable by all our standard prevention measures. Our only serious concern is, will our vaccines protect against it? And for that, we don't have that information just yet. That takes, you know, a good 2-3 weeks to get that information. But we can make some extrapolation to suggest that basically, when we look at all of the other four variants of concern, the vaccines have tended to do quite well in preventing severe disease and hospitalization. In fact, most of them are, you know, in excess of 90% efficacious in preventing severe disease, but they don't do as well in preventing mild infection. So that's probably going to happen, and we're probably going to start seeing reinfections in those who have had previous natural infections.
Goodness. So while we're waiting for all that, while we're playing wait and see, Australia is among several countries to have closed its borders to travellers from South African nations. Is that the right thing for us to be doing?
Unfortunately, it's the wrong thing to do because it doesn't help. A virus like this is going to reach every part of the world, whether we like it or not. And what, you know, if you're looking at trying to prevent people from coming to Australia with this virus, you're pretty much going to have to shut off almost every country. Because if you look at the Delta variant, within 3 weeks, it was in 53 countries with local transmission. We know that the first case of this virus was detected with hindsight, you know, when we do the back calculations on the 9th of November. So it's probably almost in every other country or in most other countries that have had people traveling. So based on that, you know, it's really a short-term measure, if anything, and it's unlikely to be particularly helpful. I would suggest that the way to deal with the travel problem is really to deal with it with the four approaches that we use, which is to make sure only vaccinated people travel, to make sure that they leave with a negative test result, that they are tested on arrival, and that they wear their masks during the entire journey. And those four things will reduce that risk more than any ban on travel.
Do the sort of Western nations who've been bolstering up their own vaccination levels need to do more to help out countries in Southern Africa to get the levels up there so we don't see any more of these variants?
Unfortunately, with these variants, it's not simply a matter of vaccination coverage. These variants tend to largely be generated in individuals who are severely immunocompromised. So these are patients with advanced cancer or undergoing transplant treatment or have severe immunocompromised HIV infection or in a whole range of immunocompromised states. And in those individuals, because they, when they get infected, they have a persistent infection, the virus slowly evolves in that person, getting multiple changes. In normal people, you know, you would get infected with the virus, you'd clear it in 2 weeks, and that's the end of the story. If you get, you know, persistent infection, you'll probably be positive for like a month, but that's about it. So in that sense, it's a group of people that are really hard to deal with because they're immunocompromised. They don't respond well to vaccines. So you have to give them 3-4 doses before they develop good immune responses. So it's a broader issue than simply a vaccine inequity issue, which by itself, of course, is a major concern that wealthy countries have bought up vaccines and have largely stockpiled them, and that has led to Africa not having access to vaccines until recently.
Just finally, Professor, we appreciate your candor, but it's not exactly the news we want to hear. How long will it take for vaccines to adapt and combat the strain?
So at least three of the companies are already working on a revised version of their vaccines. But even if they make a vaccine, which will probably take about 2 to 3 months, they would still have to manufacture it, and then we would still have to give it to people. Now, if you take Delta as our experience, the first case of Delta that was identified in India was on the 25th of March. It's now the 25th of November. So we're looking at a period of, 6-7 months. And Delta is going to be, you know, pretty much wiped out, you know, in the course of this new variant in all likelihood. And it was the same previously. Alpha gets wiped out, you know, by Delta, and Delta now will get wiped out by something else. So these variants are quite short-lived in grander scheme of time. And so even if you get a vaccine, by the time you vaccinate people, you're pretty much now dealing with the next variant. So that's the challenge we have with vaccines.
Professor, thank you so much for coming on our show. We do appreciate your expertise. Professor Karim Foote joining us from Johannesburg there.